amazing at how he was punished. In Numbers, the 32nd chapter and the 23rd verse, we read, "Be sure your sin will find you out." So there's no such thing then, is there, of secret sin. Because we see in Gehazi the type of all sin. All sin is like his in its method. It never remains stationary. It grows and grows and it stretches from one thing to another. One sin leads to another sin. So all sin is like Gehazi's in selfishness. He should have respected his master Elisha's honor and position in the sight of this foreign prince, Naaman, but he didn't. All he thought of was his own personal gain. See, sin is very selfish. It always places personal interests before the interests of all other people. Selfish. And all sin is alike in that there's an end result. What is that end result? That's punishment. Death and punishment. Separation from God. The wicked persuade themselves that their wrongdoing isn't noticed. Nobody sees it. But not so. Because soon, very soon, it will be made manifest. Every thought as well as every deed will be brought out into the open, will be made known. And the day of reckoning will arrive, because there's no such thing as a secret sin. So this lesson today follows immediately after last week's lesson, and it has so many lessons in it for us to learn today. Naaman was filled with joy, if you remember, how glad he was that he listened to the counsel of his servants finally, and that he hadn't let his anger prevail against their advice, but rather, as they sat down and reasoned with him, he listened, and he began to clearly see his own selfish, foolish ways. And he rectified them by going, as he was instructed, to the Jordan River. And even though he only dipped himself in the water, he didn't immerse himself, he just dipped himself in the water 7 times, God honored his efforts and healed him of his leprosy. And it was very evident after that his heart was just overflowing with gratefulness and gratitude. He was a changed man. He really was. And like the lepers in Luke's gospel in the 17th chapter of Luke, he returned to give glory to God. He went back to Elijah and gave glory to Elijah's God. That's where our lesson starts today. So let's read verses 15 through 18 today. Or through 19, rather. 15 through 19. He returned to the man of God, and I'll read with you. And he returned to the man of God, he and all his company, and came and stood before him. And he said, "Behold, now I know that there is no God in all the earth but in Israel. Now therefore I pray thee, take a blessing of thy servant." But he said, "As the Lord liveth before whom I stand, I will receive none." And he urged him to take it, but he refused. And Naaman said, "Shall there not then, I pray thee, be given to thy servant 2 mules burden of earth? For thy servant will henceforth offer neither burnt offering nor sacrifice unto other gods, but unto the Lord. In this thing the Lord pardon thy servant, that when my master goeth into the house of Rimmon to worship there, and he leans on my hand, and I bow myself in the house of Rimmon, when I bow down myself in the house of Rimmon, the Lord pardon thy servant in this thing." And he said unto him, "Go and keep peace." So he departed from him a little way. Well, Naaman's wonderful cure had made him a believer in the God of Israel, and Jehovah God, Elijah's God. And notice how different he is now as he approaches. answers Elisha. If you remember, before when he went to Elisha for help, he rode up to his door in his chariot and sat there and he waited for Elisha to come out to him. But this time, he's different. This time, he gets out and he humbly enters the prophet's house. He doesn't wait for Elijah to rush out to meet him. This time, there's a spirit of gratefulness, a spirit of gratitude to God and to God's prophet, and it's beginning to show in Naaman now. So he came and he stood before Elisha, and he said, "I pray thee, take a blessing of thy servant. Take a blessing. Accept a present from me and from my servants. Please, I have a present for you. I have silver, I have gold, I have some other fine garments, some new clothes for you. Whatever else you need, I'll give it to you." Naaman would be glad to pay for his cure. He was so grateful. And besides, it was a common thing in those days to give presents to all those great official prominent men, prophets included. But Elisha refused. Now, why would he refuse such a grateful, thankful response? Well, it was because Elisha did not want it to appear to the Syrians that he'd taken presents as a remuneration, as pay, for the cure of leprosy, because God alone had done the work, and God alone should receive all of the glory. So Elisha refused the presents, and he backed his refusal with an oath. He said to Naaman, "As the Lord lives, I will receive none." Not because he didn't need it, because he was poor, he needed it, but he could have used it himself. And he would have used it. He would have used it to help the prophets of men over there in that school of prophets. Nor was it unlawful for him to take presents, because he had received presents from others. But he was not going to be beholden to this Syrian, lest he say, "I've made this prophet Elisha rich." Elisha had to show him that the gift of God could not be purchased, could not be bought with money. He had to show this new convert that the servants of the God of Israel were taught to look upon the wealth of this world with a holy contempt, which would then confirm him in his belief that there really was no God except the God of Israel. Elisha had to prove to Naaman and impress upon this ignorant yet intelligent heathen that Jehovah was a God not like any other God, and that his prophets were not like any other men. So when Naaman found out that Elisha would take his gifts, he would receive them, he decided to show his gratitude in another way, because he's firmly resolved now that he's not only going to offer sacrifice to the God of Israel, but he declares that he will never offer sacrifices to any other gods, and he'll only offer sacrifice to the God of Israel. He's making it known to that, because he was cured of leprosy. So he pleads with Elijah more. He pleads that he be permitted to take with him 2 mules' burdens worth of earth from the Holy Land, from Israel. As much dirt from it that 2 mules could carry. That's what he's asking for. And he made to make an altar for the worship of Jehovah, the God of Israel, because he had now resolved to worship him and him only. And this dirt would connect his sacrifices with the place of God's, the God of Israel's, special habitation that would connect him. So he asked for this soil from Israel. Most people believed in that day that deities had power only in their own land, their own soil. So now Naaman wanted to build an altar to Jehovah the Lord with dirt from the land of Israel to make sure that God would be present when he worshiped in his homeland of option, or maybe he deprived him of favor from the court, but he still didn't hesitate. He didn't change his mind. He made the resolution and he proclaimed it. And whether he kept this resolution or not, we really aren't told and we really don't know. We don't know anything much about his life after this because the curtain drops on him as soon as he goes back to his own country in Syria. But at least this was what he asked for. We do know that as sincere as he was about serving the God of Israel in his own homeland in Syria when he got back there, and although he was a changed man and no longer an idolater, we do know that he was still wanting in his decision because he asked Elisha for one more thing. Now notice carefully what it was that he asked. He asked Elisha for the liberty to bow down when he went into the house of Rimmon in Syria as showing respect to his king, when he went in there with his king and to show his king respect, and in compliance with his duties as the king's general in this one thing, he asked to be excused. He asked to be pardoned for bowing in the temple of the god of Rimmon when his master the king went in to worship there and he went with them. Rimmon was supposed to have been a prominent deity of the Syrians. He had some connection with sun worship. I don't know that he was the god of sun worship, but he had a connection there. He was a deity of the Syrians. And whenever the king went into the house of Rimmon, he always leaned on the arm of one of his chief officers. And this is what Naaman is talking about because he is the king's chief general and the chief officer. So he knows he's going to attend the king when the king goes to worship this sun god or whatever god it was, the god of Rimmon. He knows he shouldn't do it, but he can't help not do it. Otherwise, he loses his office. He loses his position. So he protests to Elisha that he would not be bowing down to the idol, he would not be honoring that idol, but he would only be honoring and respecting his king. And therefore, he hopes that God will forgive him. And Elisha said, "Go in peace." Now, some people think that Elisha's answer gave Naaman permission to go through with this outward form of idolatry. But Elisha didn't mean that at all. All that Elisha did was to give Naaman the Eastern form of saying goodbye. He didn't condemn his actions. He didn't approve of them. He just said goodbye. And it left it up to Naaman's own conscience. This is a lesson for us. We can't lay down hard and fast rules for other people. We have to let God deal with it. But anyone who truly hates evil will avoid even every appearance of evil. All appearance of evil. It's found in 1 Thessalonians, the 5th chapter, and the 22nd verse. There is a scripture that says avoid all evil. But in this scripture, in 1 Thessalonians, it says avoid all appearance, even the appearance of evil. So while we make every allowance for Naaman, who spent all his life in heathenism, we can't imitate him in his lack of decision because we, like Naaman, owe our allegiance to a higher king than the king of Syria. When it comes to a matter of conscience, let no man be our master, no one but Jesus. We must never, never, never forsake godly principles, because it's expedient. It's absolutely necessary. It's expedient to obey God rather than the voice of popularity. So Elisha simply said goodbye to Naaman, and Naaman walked away. Elisha didn't say whether God would or would not forgive Naaman for his departure from the path. Strict righteousness. He wasn't called upon by God to give any answers to me. All he said was, go in peace, which simply meant, God be with you on your journey back home. Goodbye. Just look at how unselfish Elisha was in all of this. First, he stood right there before Naaman and gently refused his tempting offers, those presents, because Elisha thought first about the honor of his God. And he knew very well that it wasn't by his own words or his own power that Naaman had been healed of his leprosy. He knew it was nothing but by the power of the living God. And he wanted Naaman to think of God in all of this and not of himself, not of Elisha. And secondly, Elisha thought of the honor of his religion. And that's something for us to think about. Are we good representatives of the Jesus that we hold in our hearts? We call ourselves Christians. We wear crosses, we go around, and we call ourselves Christians. We're examples of the Jesus that we hold in our heart. And what kind of examples are we? Or in our inconsistencies and in our excuses, we all have them. Are we bringing a reproach upon the God that we profess to believe in and to serve? And finally, look at Elisha. He thought also Naaman's good. He didn't want to just benefit his physical body by curing him from leprosy. He wanted to benefit Naaman's soul as well. And therefore, he avoided everything that might be a stumbling block to Naaman. And Elisha simply said, goodbye, Naaman. Go in peace, meaning have a good trip back to your home in Syria, and may the presence of God be with you. So Naaman turned around and left the presence of Elisha, and he headed for home, back to Syria. But he hadn't gotten very far when he heard someone yelling. And he turned around and saw someone running to him, trying to flag him down. Someone was coming after him. Who was it? Let's read verses 20 through 24. But Gehazi, the servant of Elisha, the man of God, said, behold, my master has spared Naaman the Syrian in not receiving at his hands that which he brought. But as the Lord liveth, I'll run after him, and I'll take somewhat of him. So Gehazi followed after Naaman, and when Naaman saw him running after him, he lighted down from the chariot to meet him, and he said, is all well? And he said, all well. My master sent me, saying, behold, even now there be come to me from Mount Ephraim two young men of the sons of the prophets. Give them, I pray thee, a talent of silver and two changes of garments. And Naaman said, be content, take two talents. And he urged him, bound two talents of silver in two bags with two changes of garments, and laid them upon two of his servants, and they bore them before him. And when he came to the tower, he took them from their hand, bestowed them in the house, and let the men go, and they departed. How different from Elisha, Gehazi's master, than Gehazi, Elisha's servant. How different from Elisha's selfishness, his honor of religion, the honor of his country, the honor of his God was Gehazi. None of these things seemed to have entered Gehazi's thoughts. Not even his master's honor didn't seem of any account to him now. Elisha had refused to take any of Naaman's gifts. And now, self seems to be Gehazi's master. Elisha had refused the gifts that Naaman had offered him. But Gehazi coveted those gifts. He blamed Elisha for not accepting the gold and the silver. And he accused him of being foolish because he envied and begrudged Elisha's kindness to Naaman, even though it was for the good of Naaman's short, Gehazi thought he was wiser than his master. But the truth was, the love of money, that was Gehazi's sin, the love of money. So he runs after him. His master foolishly refused those presents, but he was, and he's about now to flag down Naaman. And when Naaman heard someone yelling behind him, he stopped his chariot, he looked back, he got out, he saw someone coming toward him. And as he got closer, he recognized who it was. So he walked back to meet the haste. He thought, surely something's got to be wrong. So he inquired and he said, Gehazi, is anything wrong? What's wrong? Oh, no, Gehazi said. All's well. There hasn't been any accidents. No calamities. All's well. There's just been a change of circumstances. Just a little change, Naaman, in circumstances. And that's caused a change in my master Elisha's wishes. So he sent me out here to flag you down, to talk to you about it before you got away. Elisha's just been over to Ephraim. He's been over there to the school of prophets, Naaman. And there are two boys over there. They're in destitute trouble. They need money. They need money to pay their tuition and to buy some new clothes for themselves. And so Elisha's changed his mind because he doesn't have that of his boy. He doesn't have that. So he's changed his mind. And so he sent me to run after you to ask you for a talent of silver and a change of garments so that he can take them and give them to those boys over there in the prophets, where the prophets are. Now, this was a lie. This was a total lie. Gehazi was lying through his teeth. It was a deliberate lie because Gehazi was asking for these gifts for himself, not for Elisha, not for those boys at all. It was for himself. He intended all along to buy things for himself, vineyards, sheep, olive yards. He had great plans for what he was going to do with this money. It'd never be taken, given to Elisha. Well, Naaman might not discern this, but God had been watching. God saw through the bottom of all of it. God knows our thoughts even before we do it in action. And God knew all about what was going on in Gehazi's heart. Gehazi's act, however, so skillfully concealed from human eyes, did not go unseen by God. God saw it all. But Naaman was deceived and gladly gave to Gehazi even more than he'd asked for. He said, oh, not just one talent, but here, I'll give you two. Take two talents of silver, two talents of gold, and here, take more than just one change of clothes. Take a couple changes of clothes for those boys. So you see, Naaman more than doubled what was asked for. He was so glad to have an opportunity at last to show Elisha how grateful and thankful he was for his cure of leprosy. So he sent two of his servants to help Naaman carry back to Elisha these sacks of silver and gold. They were heavy. But needless to say, the silver and this gold and these new clothes never did get to Elisha, because when they got back close to the palace, king's palace in Syria, Gehazi took the treasures from his servants and he dismissed them. He said, that's fine now, I'll take care of this by myself. Because he was about, and he did, smuggle that silver and that gold and all those clothes. What did he do? He smuggled them into his own house. He didn't even want the servants around to see it. He thought if they didn't see him, nobody saw him. And he smuggled it all into his own house and he hid them. And now he could breathe a breath of relief. These valuables, oh, they were so safely hidden away. He did just like Achan did, if you remember, when he took the spoils back there in Joshua, in the 7th chapter. Gehazi hid them. He thought they were safe and hid away in a secret hiding place in his own house until things calmed down a little and he had an opportunity to start using them. And notice how one sin now leads to another. First, Gehazi begins with covetous. He wants something that belongs to someone else. That was our description of covetousness. And the next thing, he tells a lie, which totally deceives this foreigner. And he gets even more than he asked for. And then he hides it away when he gets it, and he thinks everything is over and everything is well. But is it? Let's read verses 25 through 27 and see how this ends. But he went in, stood before his master, and Elisha said to him, "Whence comest thou, Gehazi?" He said, "Oh, thy servant went no whither." And he said, "Went not my heart with thee when the man turned again from his chariot to meet thee? Is it a time to receive money and to receive garments and oliveyards and vineyards and sheep and oxen and men servants and maid servants? The leprosy, therefore, of Naaman shall cleave unto thee and unto thy seed forever." And he went out from his presence a leper. Spoils. Gehazi had skillfully concealed his act, or he thought he had. He's back to work now. He's back home, back in business as usual. He's standing before Elisha, ready for his next assignment. But instead of Elisha giving him Elisha looked at him and he said, "What have you been, Gehazi?" And without batting an eye, Gehazi said, "What are you asking me that question for? I haven't been anywhere." So you see, one lie leads to another. And by this time, he's so used to lying, he doesn't even know that it's a lie. All of his other lies have slowly demoralized him. That's what lying does. It demoralizes you so that you don't even realize you're telling lies. And he doesn't even hesitate to answer Elisha. He said, "Well, I don't know what you're asking me that question for. I haven't been anywhere. I haven't been out of the house, sir." Oh my goodness, he didn't know that his master's eye, Elisha, had been on him during this whole transaction. And Elisha said, "Gehazi, what you don't know is that my heart went with you. You ran after Naaman and you stopped him when he was on his way to Syria home." How did Elisha know this? Well, the spirit of prophecy was on him. He was God's prophet. Gehazi had forgotten that Elisha was God's prophet, and that the spirit of prophecy upon him would let him not be deceived, and that it was in vain for him, for Gehazi, to lie to the Holy Ghost. Elisha could tell him what he had done, even though Gehazi denied it. "You said you didn't go anywhere, Gehazi, but I have to let you know, my heart went with you." Gehazi had something yet to learn. He had to learn that God's prophets had spiritual eyes and that he couldn't hide one thing from God's prophets. So Elisha could tell Gehazi every one of his secret thoughts because he knew that Gehazi had gotten 2 talents to purchase land, to purchase cattle, to purchase oxen, to purchase vineyards for himself. He's going to leave Elisha's service now. He's got money. He's got everything he needs. He doesn't need to be Elisha's servant any longer. He's all set up for himself. Now remember, all of our foolish hopes, all of our plans, church, are open to the eyes of God. He even knows our thoughts. He even knows what we're going to ask before we ask. Do you know that? So now Elisha tells Gehazi the evil of it. "Gehazi, is this the time to receive money? I can give. Is this an opportunity for you to enrich yourself? Couldn't you have found a better way of getting money than by lying to your master and being a stumble block to a new convert? By lying to me and being a stumbling block to Naaman, a heathen, a new convert? Or being, what's wrong with you, Gehazi? This is not a time to increase your wealth. It's not a time to increase our wealth when we can't do it by such means that are dishonorable to God and injurious to others. It's not a time for us to do that. So Gehazi, Elisha said, is this a time to receive money and clothes so that you can buy vineyards for yourself, so that you can buy olive gardens, sheep, oxen, manservants, maidservants? Is that, you think this is time to do this? You think this is all right, Gehazi? So you see, Elisha quickly exposed Gehazi's sin. And what will it all fall? Nothing but punishment. Because Gehazi had made the grace of God of no effect. Gehazi, I hate to tell you this, but the leprosy of Naaman is going to cleave unto you and to your children and to your seed, your children. Money won't get you to heaven. And woe upon those preachers today who are preaching messages of money, gospel of money. For sure, we didn't come into this world with anything, and we're not going to leave it with anything. Have you ever seen a hearse pulling a U-Haul behind? Ever seen a hearse pulling a U-Haul trailer behind it? Not going to take anything with you. Gehazi tried to hide everything. But there's no such thing as a secret sin. So, in closing our lesson, remember, the golden text says it all. So let's read it together. It's out of 1 Timothy 6 through 10. And it says, for the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some coveted after, have erred from the faith, and pierced themselves through with sorrows. This love for money is rampant in our country, in this generation today, and we need to be very aware that the love of money is the root. The love of money, not money, it is the love of is the root of all evil. And don't we see that? We see people over in foreign countries, they go there to make money. We see our insurance companies, we see the pharmaceutical companies, we see our insurance company absolutely robbing people of money. We pay into the insurance companies every month, most of us, our cars, our health insurance. But when it comes time for us to receive that remuneration, well, then we have to fight. The love of money, greed, is rampant.
okay that we are the, you know, property also says that we're walking in darkness and don't know what is done with that. And I, this verse in Genesis just sticks with me so much, when the Lord is speaking to Cain after he murdered Abel. And he said, why art thou wroth? Why is thy countenance fallen? If thou doest well, shalt thou not be accepted? And if thou doest not well, sin lieth at the door.
I teach that in counsel always, always. I use Cain and Abel. God looked at Cain and said, he saw in his face, in the different promises, what's wrong, Cain? I can tell by your face something's wrong. And then God said this, and you quoted it, but I'm going to put it in a common language. He said, Cain, if you do right, you will feel right. Now everybody says, oh yeah, God gives us feelings, and right he does. Oh, well, we do have feelings. But what he wants to teach us is that our feelings should come under the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, that we should, our actions should be guided by the Holy Spirit. And if we do right, then we're going to feel right. We can't go by our feelings. They'll lead us astray. That's what he was telling Cain. He said, I can tell. But he said, Cain, I can tell you how to fix that. If you'd only do right, you're going to feel right. But you're not going to feel right if you do right. Amen?
Certain sin started with a lie. That's how the whole thing started with a falsehood. Involved in that.
That's right. Yeah. Yes. Exactly. Exactly. Father God, thank you for reminding us from your word. And I pray, God, today that as we live in these perilous times, and there are many poor, and we sometimes think what's going to happen to us when we hear the reports. Stock market's going down, taxes going up. We just hear now this winter, they're already telling us, they're already trying to put the fear of God in us that we're not going to be able to pay for the heat to heat our homes this winter. The price of gas is going to go up, groceries are going to go up, the shelves are going to be empty. Buy up quickly, send your Christmas presents early. Oh my God. These are perilous times, and we need you now today more than we've ever needed you in any time in our lives. So, Father God, help us to remember that you see every deed we do. Help us to remember that riches won't get us anywhere. In fact, all the money belongs to you. Your word says that you own the cattle on a thousand hills. You don't just own the cattle, you own the hills they stand on. And so we look to you, Father God, maker of heaven and earth and all that is therein, to supply our every need. You said that if we serve you, we will not ever beg for bread, nor will our children or our children's children. So today, Lord God, we get a lesson from Gehazi. We get a lesson from Naaman. We get a lesson from Elisha. We get a lesson from your word every time we read it. Father God, help us not just to hear it, not just to proclaim it, not just to go and talk about it, but to take it into every part of our innermost brain, spirit, soul, mind, and body so that we'll put it into action. And we will walk in the Spirit and not obey the lusts of the flesh. Help us, Jesus, to that end. In your precious Son's name.